Geuser, many thanks for your warm welcome. I think after having seen and celebrated with you Holy Mass in your beautiful chapel, heard the beautiful choir, seen your participation in Mass, we can do a lot more in St. Rochus to better our liturgy. But we are very glad if you come to St. Rochus and help us. Dear President and Rector, Professor Dr. Christian Geuser, dear Dean, Professor Dr. Bernhard Dollner, dear faculty, dear members of the staff and dear students, dear friends and supporters of the International Theological Institute at Trumau, dear ladies and gentlemen. I thank you for your kind invitation to give a talk on Blessed John Henry, Cardinal Newman, on your feast day, the 23rd Dies Natalis of your Institute, for which we are all very, very grateful to God. Again, cordial congratulations and at plurimus annus. Again, you have not chosen a theologian to give a talk on Blessed John Henry Newman on your feast day, but a simple fellow oratorian of Newman. Therefore, I suppose that today you are mainly interested in his spirituality and in view of his forthcoming canonization by Pope Francis. I've chosen as a theme of this address to you, Blessed Cardinal John Henry Newman, Holiness Rather Than Peace. Blessed John Henry Newman once wrote, "One of the sure signs of the Spirit of God is peace. The saints have gone through many fierce trials. I do not read that they were restless. No two saints can be so different from each other as St. Philip and St. Ignatius, one so unassuming, the other so imperial. They are both, in different ways, inexpressibly calm. The calmness of St. Philip took the form of cheerfulness, that of St. Ignatius the form of majesty. The first element in St. Philip's spirit is rest and peace. If you are going to contemplate Newman's lifelong quest for holiness under the heading Holiness Rather Than Peace, we have to keep in mind the rules of the discretion of the spirits, which St. Ignatius of Loyola gave in his exercises. God gives peace where he wants our hearts to dwell, but he leaves us in unrest wherever we have not yet reached his goal. And St. Augustine's famous words come to mind as well, our heart is restless until it rests in you. Whereas the invidious enemy, according to St. Ignatius, under the disguise of an angel of the light, can give consolation to the soul in order to entrap her. Newman's battle against any kind of deceitful peace would start with the first fundamental conversion in his life. At the age of 15 years, he turned, mainly under the influence of two saintly Anglican clergymen, Walter Mayers and Thomas Scott, from near atheism into a deep Christian faith, which he experienced in a supernatural awareness of a distinct presence of a personal God in his life. In answer to God's call, John Henry was willing to give himself up entirely to the truth which he had mercifully found. So he adopted the motto, Holiness Rather Than Peace, from his spiritual teacher, Thomas Scott, whom he deeply admired for his bold unworldliness and his struggle towards holiness of life for both himself and his flock. In his writings, Scott heavily insisted on the conscience as a moral guide. From Newman in his footsteps, conscience and a sincere search for truth should always exclude any compromise for the sake of a peace that is no peace. On the role of conscience, he later wrote, may we not look for a blessing through obedience, even to an erroneous system, and a guidance by means of it, out of it? Certainly, I've always contended that obedience, even to an erroneous conscience, was the way to gain light, and that it mattered not where a man began, so that he began on what he came to hand and in faith, and that anything might become a divine method of truth. Did the young John Henry foresee how many trials, how many battles his attempt to follow God in obedience, the one God in three persons who had revealed himself and who by the light of faith had made this revelation a compass of truth in human's own heart, would cost him in the course of the remaining 74 years of his life? But from the first day he never ceased to trust in God's assistance to enable him to serve God faithfully. He did not start his journey for truth merely in reliance on his intellectual capacities, but principally on God's guidance through grace. His famous hymn, "Lead kindly light amidst the encircling gloom, lead thou me on, one step enough for me," captures this attitude in a few words. Actually, in order to understand Newman's holiness, which might not seem outstanding or extraordinary to some, we have to look on the profoundly supernatural perspective in which Blessed John Henry would view all phenomena around him from the early experience of his calling and throughout his life. He tried to interpret them in God's light and then to please God as perfectly as possible, no less in the humdrum duties of everyday life as amidst trials and temptations. As a Catholic priest, when suffering seemed to reach a special climax at the time when he was threatened by imprisonment due to the uncertain result of the famous Achille trial, Newman had publicly uncovered the misdemeanors and unreliability of the ex-priest Achille, who had been attacking the church in the journals. Achille then tried to have him convicted for calumny. He told his confreres at the Oratory in Birmingham, I do not suppose that either you or I feel able simply to rejoice and exult today in our secret hearts. Yet reason tells us we ought to do so. It is natural we should be depressed. It is reasonable we should triumph. It is from human feelings that we are sad. It will be from grace if we are satisfied and thankful. Human feeling is not wrong, but grace is better. This is a perfect example of the dialectic in which Newman would find himself throughout his life, fighting for truth and doing his duty as a priest in defending the church made him suffer persecution, unrest, and anxiety. In God, he found peace in the deepest recess of his heart. Here we find a key to the secret of his intimate holiness. Christian holiness certainly is personal, but never private. Newman's own quest for truth, which left him no peace until he had found it in the fullness of the faith in the Catholic Church, would become a source of grace for others. In the end, it brought much good, not only for the cause of Catholicism, but also for many Anglicans. His philosophical and theological arguments against rigorous religious liberalism have strengthened and empowered to this day the faith of many Christians of all confessions. Therefore, he is now acclaimed far beyond the Catholic Church as a saint and doctor for our modern times. We look up to his arguments in a time in which Benedict XVI has warned against a dictatorship of relativism, in which God is no longer recognized as a source of law or objective truth, to which conscience feels committed. We admire Newman's insight in the power of reason when natural law, intelligible to the human mind and only a few decades ago, nearly universally accepted in the Declaration of Human Rights, seems in process of being gradually replaced by arbitrary ideologies dictated by influential lobbies. We marvel at Newman's powerful gift to defend the truth when it is difficult nowadays to engage in rational conversations on the questions of the dignity of human life, on marriage and sexual identity. We are strengthened by his clear teaching at a time when subjectivism and relativism have spread even within the Church, as St. John Paul II warned in his encyclical Veritatis Splendor. Newman had foreseen the dangers of such developments and fought against their underlying principles more than 100 years ago in his absolute commitment to God's revelation and the correct interpretation of conscience. Pope John Paul II seems to bear all this in mind when he prominently quotes Newman in this important encyclical. He names him the defender of the rights, but also the teacher of the duties of conscience. Newman's influence on the Second Vatican Council is well known, and he is 4 times quoted in the Catechism of the Catholic Church. Newman could proclaim consistently and credibly the duties of conscience, since he understood his own life as a continuous experience of God's guidance. Although brought up in an Anglican family, which even if perhaps not fervent in the faith, had still taught him to pray, read the Bible, and go to church, at the age of 14, he fell under the influence of the literature of enlightenment. This resulted in doubt, skepticism, perhaps even a loss of faith. Sadly, the boy remarked on Voltaire's denial of the immortality of the soul, how dreadful, but how plausible. A long and maybe nearly fatal illness during the summer month initiated the salutary process of conversion in his mind, which I mentioned above. When I was 15, in the autumn of 1816, a great change took place in me. I fell under the influence of a definite creed and received into my intellect impressions of dogma, which, through God's mercy, have never been effaced or obscured. Dogma, which he later defined as a supernatural truth, irrevocably committed to human language, would from this moment on be the pivot and basis for both his intellectual perception and moral principle. He was convinced that he would be lost without its guiding light. In consequence, once he had come to a realization of the rationality of Christian faith, he defended its creed, which he had now received throughout his life. Hence it was on the basis of his own experience that he became the great doctor of conscience, as the interior voice of God in our heart, and furthermore, a proof of the existence of God. You must always keep in mind that Newman's powerful teaching reflects his personal history of salvation. His conversion was not a sudden awakening event, as happens in evangelical or charismatic faith communities. Rather, he describes it as a process that began with his long illness in summer 1816. This process lasted through the autumn and into the winter and ended with firm resolutions. It consisted in listening, reading, praying, discernment, and finally moral and intellectual decisions under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. One cannot but be reminded of the exercises of St. Ignatius, of their Principium and Fundamentum, and the first series of meditations when we read the following words of Newman: "From this time I have held with a full inward assent and belief the doctrine of eternal punishment, as delivered by our Lord himself, in as true a sense as I hold that of eternal happiness. So I have tried in various ways to make that truth less terrible to the imagination." Or when we hear that in these days John Henry made the decision to lead a celibate life as a sacrifice for God and his church. All of Newman's contemporaries give a testimony to the purity of life which he led in Oxford, starting as an undergraduate, 16 years old, at Trinity College. On his arrival, he was appalled by the worldliness of many of the students and many of the fellows in this ecclesiastical university, and horrified especially by the drunken excesses of Gaudy Night directly after having taken communion on Trinity Sunday. In the first years, he was despised and bullied by fellow students for not attending drunken events like this and keeping instead to his rooms. Later, as a fellow of Oriel College and preacher at the University Church of St. Mary's, he did his best to impress on his listeners the grave and earnest character of God's word and the beauty of Christian holiness. But what gained him fame and a wide following was a struggle he now embarked on to renew the religious life of the Church of England. His first aim was to defend her from political and worldly interference. Later, as we know, he wanted to correct Protestant features incompatible with the Church of Antiquity, the Church of the Fathers, whom he had begun to read. The years of his contributions to the famous Tracts for the Times, 1833 to 1841, would become the happiest time of his life. He must have felt that the kindly light of God was leading him step by step, and that he could serve the Anglican Church best in strengthening her Catholic doctrines and defending her against liberal ideas. He gradually absorbed the principles and treasures of the writings of the Fathers and became more and more confirmed in his views. These happy days, surrounded and supported by so many friends in the Tractarian movement, such as John Keble, Edward Bouverie Pusey, Richard Harrell Froude, Richard William Church, Robert Wilberforce, Thomas Mosley, and others, came to a sudden, if not unforeseen, end when he published his boldest tract, Tract 90. For the last time and without great hopes, he tried to convince himself and others of the possibility of a Catholic interpretation of the 39 articles of religion of the Anglican Creed, relying chiefly on the teachings of the great Anglican divines of the 17th century. As we know, the reaction to this tract was mainly negative. And the years thereafter, 1841 to 1845, would be a purgatory for him. The more he had read the Fathers of the Church, the more he had come to doubt that the Church of England, even if she had the marks of antiquity, apostolicity, and holiness, really was, as he had long maintained, the via media, between the errors of Protestantism and Roman corruptions. The question arose whether she truly could call herself one and Catholic. As he did not want to sow his own doubts in others, while failing to provide the answers he had not found for himself, he gradually withdrew from public life to Littlemore, a little village near Oxford which belonged to his parish. He was widely suspected, nevertheless, of having secretly converted to Rome. His mind was torn by arguments both for and against the Anglican faith, for and against the Church of Rome. During this time, he took to much prayer and fasting and studying. He delved into a study of where the Roman Church had stood in the great battles for orthodoxy in the first centuries, especially in the Arian crisis. In the end, he started to write his famous essay on the development of Christian doctrine, which he drew to a close when he became convinced that Rome had continually kept the true doctrine against heresy in the times of antiquity, and that later doctrinal developments in the Church, as defined in the decrees of the Council of Trent, were in organic conformity with the old teachings. Finally, at his own free request, he was received by Blessed Dominic Barberi of the Passionist Fathers into the Catholic Church on 9th October 1845 in Littlemore, a step for which he prepared himself by a general confession that lasted for several hours. From this time that I became a Catholic, of course, I have no further history of my religious opinions to narrate. John Henry writes about his conversion in the Apologia Pro Vita Sua, adding, "In saying this, I do not mean to say that my mind has been idle, or that I have given up thinking on theological subjects, but that I have had no variations to record, and have no anxiety of heart whatever. I have been in perfect peace and contentment. I never have had any doubt. I was not conscious to myself on my conversion of any change, intellectual or moral, brought in my mind. I was not conscious of firmer faith in the fundamental truth of revelation, or of more self-command. I had not more fervor, but it was like coming into port after a rough sea, and my happiness on that score remains to this day without interruption." Newman once remarked, "This necessity of being sanctified wholly, in the apostles' language, is often forgotten. It is indeed comparatively easy to profess one side only of moral excellence, as if faith were to be all in all, or zeal, or amiableness, whereas in truth, religious obedience is a very intricate problem, and the more so, the farther we proceed in it. The moral growth within us must be symmetrical in order to be beautiful and lasting. Hence, mature sanctity is seldom recognized by others, where it really exists, never by the world at large." We have looked at the sincere and indeed heroic battle which Blessed John Henry fought in the intellectual sphere, the predictable region for attempts by the invidious enemy to waylay men of his stamp into sins against humility and sincerity in thought. It is now time to look at the unfolding of the other theological virtues in his life, those of hope and charity. Doubtless, there were many happy moments in Newman's Catholic life. But during many years of it, he felt he was living under a cloud. Until the liberating moment in 1879, when Pope Leo XIII elevated him to the cardinalate. Owing to his abilities, he saw himself after his conversion with the duty to provide both clergy and laity in the Catholic Church in England with intellectual formation. One must bear in mind that it was only after the Catholic Relief Act of 1829 that Catholic schools were permitted in Great Britain, and that until 1854, no Catholic could study at Oxford, as until then each student had to take an oath to adhere to the 39 Articles of the Church of England. Indeed, Newman was warmly encouraged by both the Pope and the English hierarchy to realize this mission of education and formation. With this in mind, he first undertook the foundation of the Oratory of St. Philip Neri in England, and later its still thriving Oratory School. The next project was the foundation of the first Catholic university in Great Britain since the Reformation. To Newman's great disappointment, it had to be in Dublin instead of Oxford, on account of the resistance of the English bishops, who were afraid that if Catholics were to go to Oxford, they might lose their faith. He published numerous books and articles in journals and gave conferences. These and many other projects for the course of higher education for Catholics, he promoted with immense zeal and an infinite personal effort. He often gave all he had to give, and yet encountered in many of these endeavors unintelligible, often irrational obstacles. Ecclesiastical short-sightedness, mistrust of his good intentions, but also jealousy, malicious intrigues, and misunderstandings again and again stood in Newman's way and so sorely tried his patience. We read about the tensions between the oratories of Birmingham and London. The latter house he had also been founded by him, but later questioned his authority, the trials and anxieties of the Achille trial, a lack of suitable vocations to his own oratorian community, the insolent public imputations of Charles Kingsley against his honesty and the honesty of the Catholic clergy in general, the promised bishopric for him as rector of the Catholic University, which was prevented by intrigue, the suspicions against his orthodoxy in connection with the so-called Trembler affair, and many other trials. Another man than Newman might have despaired, might have become bitter and cynical, or at least withdrawn into retirement. We are lucky to be in the possession of over 20,000 letters of Blessed John Henry. They reveal his great warmth and charity towards others, his interest in fellow beings, his helpfulness, the prudence and patience with which he gave advice to many, and last but not least, his great sense of humor. They do not hide that he was sensitive and vulnerable, like everyone with his particular gifts. They show that he too had to struggle at times with temptations against hope and charity. But from these letters we learn how he found peace through prayer and sacrifice. From prayer he derived both hope that did not give way to resignation and forgiveness towards those who had done him harm. Much has been written and can still be written on Newman's prayer life. An expression of its intensity is found in his wonderful meditations and devotions. On the priority of prayer in John Henry's life, his oratorian confreres testified that he was habitually the first to arrive at the daily prayer times of the community, he who was the busiest of all. On the same principle, he once wrote, he you would rather give up supper than the evening meditation in common. John Henry Newman had from his formation and temperament a character which was gentle and fair-minded towards others. His ideal of a holy gentleman is well known from his book, The Idea of a University. This ideal may sound bland and gentile, but in reality it was something quite other. Already in his Anglican sermons, he had inveighed against a mere civility that apes the real virtues of patience and humility. This he repeated when addressing his fellow oratorians at Birmingham, who came from a background similar to his own, in order to draw out the essence of the idea. A quote, "We are not here contemplating refinement of mind by itself, but as superadded to a high religious perfection. And it does not follow, because refinement is worthless without saintliness, that it is needless and useless with it. It may set off and recommend an interior holiness, just as the gift of eloquence sets off logical argument. The gift of words is necessary to be able to persuade, and so the gift of manners may be necessary to win. But further than this, I suppose it may be said that true refinement of thought, word, and manners is a natural result of Christian holiness, and the necessary result when it is carried out into its full and ultimate effect." People have sometimes made the mistake of attributing Newman's human virtues solely to his formation and liberal mind, without comprehending the supernatural dynamics behind them. Without doubt, just as John Henry was a man of intellectual principles, so too he relied in the moral field on the acquisition of daily habits that help the suppression of passions and temptations and the acquisition of virtues. But these habits can be no more than a basis on which grace can build. What, he wrote, is meant by perfection? I suppose it is a power of faculty of doing our duty exactly, naturally, and completely, whatever it is, in opposition to a performance which is partial, slovenly, languid, awkward, clumsy, and with effort. It is a life of faith, hope, and charity, elicited in successive acts according to the calls of the moment and to the vocation of the individual. He is perfect who does the duties of the day perfectly. Pure natural virtues, he taught already in one of his university sermons as vicar of St. Mary's, have to be transformed by the Holy Spirit into a determinate character. And Christian holiness will always transcend them. Take at once our Lord's words when enjoining the duty of love. If ye love them who love you, what reward have ye? Do not even the publicans the same? Or St. Peter's on the duty of patience? What glory is it? When ye be buffeted for your faults, ye shall take it patiently. But if, when ye do well and suffer for it, ye take it patiently, this is acceptable with God. When in St. Philip's Oratory, living the vocation he had chosen for himself and his followers from Littlemore after his conversion to the Catholic Church, he created around himself a family life according to the rule of its founder, with a set of rules and daily customs. Until advanced age, even as a cardinal, he took part in all the community practices of the oratory, daily prayers and meals in common, general congregations, chapters of thought, and similar obligations. He took his turn like all the priests in his community, in the daily celebration of masses and in the confessional. He helped with the work in the parish and in the schools of the oratory, gave catechism classes to the Irish workers, and made sick calls and visits to prisons, like all other oratorians. Even as provost, he would, according to the oratorian rule, serve and read at table and accept no exemptions from ordinary duties. His one condition in accepting the cardinal's hat from the hands of the Pope was to be permitted to continue to live in his community in Birmingham instead, as he thought would be required of moving to Rome. One of the daily prayers at the oratory is for perseverance in God's holy service. Newman understood this prayer as a necessary intercession for grace to persevere, an absence of vows being characteristic of the oratory, in the free commitment to community life. I define perfection to be a perfect obedience. For if there be one aspect of Christianity which the apostle delineates beyond others, it is that of voluntary obedience after the pattern of Christ, he told his fellow oratorians, explaining the special form of obedience often and by many words. Conformity to the congregation and a loving submission to its will and spirit is all in all to a father of the oratory and stands in the place of all other counsels. Difficult as it is for man and wife to live together, much more difficult it is the domestic association of man with man. Even when they like and respect each other, it is most rare for men to live together and to persevere in doing so. Accordingly, we pray in the devotions of the oratory continually for perseverance. Hence it is that this gift deserves to be our peculiarity and the instrument of our perfection. It is truly a great counsel of perfection and equal to many others. No tension in this community, no open rebellion by certain members, no lack of support which he at times felt to come from confreres would induce him at any time to think of leaving the oratory. Here again, he had found peace and would certainly have repeated at the end of his life the words which he said at the time when the building of the new oratorian house in Birmingham was completed and the new refectory was blessed. I quote, "When I look back 8 or 9 years and bring before my memory the changes that took place in my life, how little could I fancy that in the course of so short a time I should find myself in a house like this, so truly a home in every sense of the word, spiritual and temporal. How little had I reason to expect, except that the word of promise was sure, that by giving up I should so soon receive back, and by losing I should gain. And what is true of me is true of you too, my dear fathers and brothers, of each in his own way." From the time of 1879, when Newman was made a cardinal, the cloud was taken from his Catholic orthodoxy, and he became a universally respected and beloved person in the church and his country. His own personal strive for holiness would go on. He cried out for spiritual fervor. It is touching to read one of the prayers he left us in his meditations and devotions. "O my God, leave me not in that dry state in which I am. Give me the comfort of thy grace. How can I have tenderness and sweetness unless I have thee to look upon? How can I continue in prayer, as is my duty doubly since I belong to the oratory, unless thou encourage me and make it pleasant to me? It is hardly that an old man keeps any warmth in him. It is slowly that he recovers what is lost. Yet, O my God, St. Philip is my father, and he seems never in his life to have been desolate. You didst give him trials, but didst thou ever take from him the light of thy countenance? O Philip, wilt thou not gain for me some tithes of thy own peace and joy, thy cheerfulness, thy gentleness, and thy self-denying charity? I am in all things the most opposite of thee, yet I represent thee. We do not know how much interior consolation and fervor of spirit Newman was granted by God, or how much dryness he had to endure in his heart. But his prayer for perseverance was certainly answered. He preserved his character of amiable charity and deep humility until the end. One touching scene is reported by Bishop Allathorne, his ordinary at Birmingham, from a visit which he paid to the cardinal in 1887, a few years before Blessed John Henry's death. He writes, "We had a long and cheery talk, but as I was rising to leave, an action of his caused a scene I shall never forget, for its sublime lesson to myself. He said in low and humble accents, 'My dear Lord, will you do me a great favor?' 'What is it?' I asked. He glided down on his knees, bent down his venerable head, and said, 'Give me your blessing.' What could I do with him before me in such a posture? I could not refuse without giving him great embarrassment. So I laid my hand on his head and said, 'My dear Lord Cardinal, notwithstanding all laws to the contrary, I pray God to bless you and that his Holy Spirit may be full in your heart.' As I walked to the door, refusing to put on his biretta as he went with me, he said, 'I have been indoors all my life, whilst you have battled for the church in the world.' I felt annihilated in his presence. There is a saint in that man." Blessed John Henry spent his last years mainly in prayer. The last mass which he could celebrate before he became unable to do so due to the fragility was on Christmas Day 1889, when his failing eyesight prevented him from reading the daily office, he permanently recited the rosary. Newman died peacefully on 11th August 1890, provided with the Holy Sacraments. Another mark of his humility came to light more than 100 years ago after his death, when his body should have been exhumed from the little Oratorian cemetery at Rednal near Birmingham in preparation for his beatification. It was found that nothing had remained of it with the exception of a pectoral cross and some rosary beads. He had disposed that his coffin should be covered with mold so that his body should rot swiftly. But in Christian hope for his soul in BB, as a last summary of the battle of his life, he had chosen as inscription on his tomb the words, "Ex umbris et imaginibus in veritatem, requiescat in pace." I have not spoken about Newman's work as a theologian, most relevant, so it is still today, because at this time we are not thinking of him as a theologian, but as a saint. But something should be said about what it was in him that endeared him to his English contemporaries and still endears him to the hearts of Englishmen today. Well into his lifetime, Catholics were viewed in his own country as in a slavery to a debased superstition, which maintained its hold on its flock through tyranny and deceit, and which placed the worldly success of the Church above sincerity and truth. Here a revolution was worked by Newman's famous account of the steps, both spiritual and intellectual, that led to his conversion. his apologia pro vita sua. It was obvious to all who read it that here was a man of total intellectual honesty who had followed the truth as its humble servant and who proved against prejudice what true Catholicism is. Most effective of all was the tribute Newman paid to the Anglicans who had formed his faith in the piety in which he had been brought up. No one, except those who knew him personally, had expected such loyalty, such affection, such humility. This is a Newman whom all Christians in his native land and his other in other lands can look back to, or rather look up to, as a saint in heaven, as a model of a charity and integrity so great as to attain heroic sanctity, and as a figure who unites together under Christ all those who love what he loved and respect what he achieved. On next 13th of October, Holy Mother Church will recognize Blessed John Henry's lifelong search for holiness and declare him one of her saints. May he soon also be declared a doctor of the Church.